So, mid-centimeters, right? I put the scores for the quiz while in the center, right? So, the mid-cent was, for the most part, like, after when I was doing the connections, I realized that I'm basically giving you all the answers. Just trying to fill in the blanks. Now, there were just a couple of few conceptual questions which are also very simple. Under a Lorentz transformation, can a space-like 4-vector be mapped into a time-like 4-vector? Now this is for 5 marks. It's a one-line answer. You can't. You can't map a space-like vector into a time-like vector. Why? Because what is the norm? The norm of how do you distinguish between space-like and time-like vectors? Space-like vectors have positive norm according to our convention. Time-like vectors have negative norm. Under the Lorentz transformation, what happens to the norm? It remains the same. So it is negative, it will stay negative. Positive, it will stay positive. Okay? So that's all that needs to be said. Then this velocity addition solved, in fact, in class we did the product rule for force and cinch, you get tan h phi plus phi prime, and then you have to use the addition formula for hyperbolic tan. So if you don't remember that formula, you might have to sit down and work it out, might take a little bit of time, but if you remember it, then that formula is simply the velocity addition. Then, I think the only question which was not so straightforward, I suppose, was 4B, right? It's one of the time dilation of the space-time diagram. So I think there were like two people who did it correctly. And maybe, so I have to check the numbers. So I gave those two people like power and something. I gave you guys 4.5 or 4.2. But almost everybody else did not. Now, some people got halfway through and you know had this sort of general idea, right? So anyways, what I have done is, for those who get it mostly correct, I have given the marks. For everybody, I have given 2.5 marks. So on your answer sheets, you will see at the front some marks plus 2.5. Okay, so now I think that given the overall level of the rest of the question thing, which is not difficult because I've given you the answers. Show that this velocity, I think I've been pretty fair with my mind. But if there are any doubts, you can always ask me. Do you have any doubts right now? Yeah. Later. Okay. All you? Yeah, later. Okay. So we'll continue with what we were doing. which was talking about the transformation of electric and magnetic fields. Now, in video lectures, somebody requested that I put the most recent one online, and I was flattered that, you know, it's like, oh, okay, unless of course you're going to make a meme out of me. So, anyways, I decided to just go ahead and make all the videos for them. Right? I was a little reluctant to do that because I was thinking maybe I will do some editing and remove background noises. And also, in some places, I say some things which are not necessarily politically correct. And so I was thinking, you know, there are like, I can't say what I want to say because it's recording. Then, let's do it. Let's put them online. They're all public. Okay? So, you can embark on your e-learning adventure. I think the sound is quite clear. The blackboard writing might not be so clear, but then most of the time when I write out my equations, I notice I tend to like speak them out. So if you follow my voice, you can figure out what is being in the moment. Okay? So now we will continue with our discussion of transformation of electric and magnetic fields. Right? So this is STEAM chapter 7. Now, the last time in the last lecture, what we had discussed was the transformation of the force for a special case where you take a certain frame of reference, you have a charge, it is moving at some velocity u, then you take another frame of reference, O prime, where O prime is moving with some velocity v, and then there are two. The first possibility is that you set u is equal to v. If you set u is equal to v, and also we set b, magnetic field should be 0 in the initial frame. So if you set u is equal to v, then the velocity of this charge in this reference frame is 0. Since the velocity is 0, there cannot be any magnetic field with that on this. Right? So we do that so that because we want to first look at the transformation law for electric fields. And so then what we do is, the root is the following. We first write down a force 4 vector, right? And it's gamma by c dv by dt, and then the force 3 vector, which is defined in terms of this force 3 vector is d of gamma and dv by dt. And so we start with this force. We say that the force is equal to E. We ask how does this force vector transform under a Lorentz transformation. And this transformation tells us finally that the electric fields in the parallel direction don't change, and the electric field in the direction perpendicular to the direction of motion undergo dilation. Right? Now there is another way to get this result without going through all this algebra, right? And this is also explained very nicely in STEAM. So you consider this thought experiment with moving capacitor plates. Okay? So you have a capacitor. So capacitor capacitor is two parallel plates, right? And there is an electric field between these two plates. Then they are separated by some distance d, right? The area of a plate is A, and the charge on each plate is Q, right? So, in the limit that these plates are infinite, the electric field inside is uniform and it is always perpendicular to the plate, and the capacitance is written as this expression, right? Capacitance can be written as charge per unit potential. Potential can be written as electric field times distance, right? And electric field is a constant here. So anyway, you get electric field turns out to be equal to Q by A epsilon naught. You can also get this from Gauss's law, right? So this is the electric field between these two things. Okay. Now we consider two cases. Again, different reference frame in which these capacitor plates are moving, right? So we can have two. We consider two cases. One in which the direction of motion is parallel to this electric field. Another in which it is perpendicular. Okay. So we have some again O prime. O prime is moving in a direction parallel to this electric field, right? So now we can ask, what is the electric field between these plates as seen by this observer, right? So this E prime would again be the parallel component would again be Q prime by A prime epsilon naught. Okay. Now charge remains in the game, right? So charge remains in the game. Area is the area of these plates and it is perpendicular to the direction of motion. So the area is not changing. So the area is also the same. So that tells you that the electric field in the parallel direction are unchanged. Okay? Now, of course, there are some possible issues with this picture. What are those possible issues? Has anybody noticed anything which might need to be taken into account, which have not changed? And I think Skeen also doesn't mention that. So you have two plates of with charges on them, right? And looking at it, at this system, when it is moving charges correspond to what? Right? There will be some magnetic fields that will be generated, right? So shouldn't I consider those magnetic fields also? So you can convince yourself that the magnetic field generated by this plate and this plate will cancel each other out, right? Because again, with a little bit of hand waving, you can think of this. If you look at it from a distance, you have a point charge plus Q and a point charge minus Q, and they are both moving in the same direction, right? So the electric field, the magnetic field generated by both of these will be opposite to each other, right? At least on the outside. Then one can look at this sheet of charge and break it up into small pieces and apply this logic to each of these pieces. Okay. So this is a subtle need, but one that should be taken into account. In any case, any case, since there is no magnetic field in this rest frame, right? You believe that there is no magnetic field, there is only a electric field. The motion might generate some magnetic field, but the electric field will not have any contribution other than this Lorentz factor. Now, what happens if you consider the case where the capacitor sheets are parallel to the direction of motion? Alright, now the separation between these plates is perpendicular to the motion, so there is no Lorentz contraction in this situation, right? But the area will undergo a Lorentz contraction, right? And so the electric field, right? So this is plus minus, so this is E perpendicular in the original rest frame. As seen in the moving frame, right? Again, E perpendicular by the same logic, Q over A prime epsilon naught, right? And what happens to the area? It shrinks by a factor of gamma. So you can write gamma Q by A epsilon naught, which is equal to gamma times the perpendicular component in the rest frame. So, you can come up with many, many configurations of charges and currents, right? You can have more than one such thought experiment. Right? So, this tells you that, well, electric fields in the parallel direction are unchanged in the perpendicular direction, they pick up a factor of gamma. Okay? Then we can do a similar thought experiment with a magnetic field, okay, to find the transformation of a magnetic field. Now, steam works through all of these different approaches, right? The first approach is this force vector approach, right? In that, you have this configuration where you have a charge that is moving with some velocity v, and then there is an observer moving with some velocity v, and this is u. In the first case, you consider u is equal to v. This tells you that what does it tell you? It tells you that E parallel is equal to E parallel, and E perpendicular is equal to gamma E perpendicular. Then you consider the second thing you can consider is U is parallel to V, but they are not equal to each other, right? So in this case, what happens? The charge still has some motion in this moving frame, right? It is moving with some velocity V minus U, right? Where minus means Lorentz minus, okay? Just writing in shorthand minus. And then again, once you work out the force on this charge, now this tells you what the magnetic field is, and you find that the magnetic field, you get again the same result for the electric fields, and the magnetic field in the perpendicular direction becomes equal to minus gamma v by c square v cross e. Okay. Now this same result can be obtained by looking at this capacitor plate setup. Okay. So let me sketch that proof for you. First, we look at a moving sheet of charge. Okay? And now this effect that I was telling you earlier, that the moving sheet of charge will lead to the generation of magnetic field, right? That's what we will be considering. So it has some width in this direction, length in this direction, and it's moving in this direction. Right? And the total charge is Q. So now one can write down the current associated with this sheet, and that current is going to be equal to QD by L. So current is charge per unit time, right? And you ask how much in some unit time delta t, right? How much charge passes through this cross section, right? That will be proportional to the total charge. Will be proportional to the velocity, right? It will be proportional to the length, and so this is the current. Okay. Now, so this is the current, right? And now remember that if you have a current carrying wire, okay? So we are just talking about a wire right now. So it's set of moving charges. What happens, it generates an electric field, a magnetic field, which is given by mu naught I by 2R, right? Where R is the distance to that point, right? Now, you imagine stacking a bunch of these wires parallel to each other, right? So you can think of this sheet of charge as a stack of wires, right? With each wire carrying current in this direction, right? Now, again, by the same logic, that when you have an infinite sheet of charge, the electric field above this sheet, so this is my infinite sheet. If it's a finite sheet, what will happen? The electric field will have a component. If I look at a point that is off center, the electric field will in general have a component going like this, right? And here it will be like this. But if I'm at the center, the components which go off to the sides will all cancel out, right? Because of the symmetry. And I'll only be left with the transverse component. And if I look at an infinite sheet of charge, then each point can be treated as a center, right? So the electric field at each point is perpendicular, and for that same reason the electric field also doesn't depend on the distance, right? Now in this case you have a moving sheet of charge, and again even though we are giving the charge this thing some dimensions, we assume that this magnetic field we will be computing is close to the center and near the center and close to the surface. Okay, so we can make the assumption of an infinite sheet for the purposes of calculating the magnetic field. So we have a bunch of wires which are all, right, this is my sheet of charge. Each wire will generate a magnetic field like this, right? So what will happen is, at any given point, the magnetic field from all of the wires, right, will act, give you something that doesn't depend on the distance. Okay? Again, as long as you are close enough to the sheet of charge to be able to make that infinite sheet approximation. Okay? And so the magnetic field in this case turns out to be in this connection there is a magnetic field. This magnetic field turns out to be equal to mu naught I by 2 W. Okay? Now, so you can calculate what this magnetic field should be by constructing an Amperean loop and integrating around that, right? So you construct a loop the same way that you calculate that electric field by putting a Gaussian surface. Here you have a sheet, this is your sheet. You consider a loop which goes like this, right? And then the current is going, let's say the sheet is moving in this direction. So it's like the current is going like this. So integral of V dot dl is equal to the current going through this loop. Right? And if you do the integral over the whole sheet, you take a loop which goes over the whole sheet, V dot dl will give you some magnetic field V times this length. Okay, because we are taking the magnetic field to be a constant in point, right? And the current, so B times L is equal to mu naught times I enclosed, right? Ampere's law. What is the total current within this enclosed by this surface? It will be proportional to. So this is the width, my bad. We are taking a loop which goes like this, right? So this is the width. So we get B times W is equal to mu naught I, something like this, right? And there will be a factor of 2 because magnetic field from here is here contributes. So you will get B naught, B is equal to mu naught I by right. Okay? Again, this is after making several assumptions. Alright? So now we ask what happens to this magnetic field when it is, so we introduce another observer, okay? And we say this observer is moving with some velocity u. We already used v, so u is here. So, as seen by this observer, what will happen? This current will change. It will become okay. So, yeah, I don't think you need to introduce this observer. So there is a little bit of again hand waving that goes on here, and if you are a little bit tolerant of hand waving, then what do you find? You find V prime using this relationship equal to mu naught I prime by 2 W. Okay, W does not undergo any change. L undergoes a Lorentz contraction. And so we can write this as, using this expression for I, we can write this as mu naught QV by W prime L prime is equal to mu naught QV by A prime. This can be written as mu naught gamma by A QB, and this can be written as gamma by C square not the most transparent derivation. So but the end result is that this magnetic field, and this is the perpendicular magnetic field, perpendicular to the direction of motion, right? This magnetic field is becomes gamma v by c squared v cross b. Okay. So by considering all these different cases, right, we end up with a set of we collect all of these expressions, and let's see what we end up with. Our final set of transformation equations for the electric and magnetic fields look like this. E perpendicular plus B cross B and let's put a vector on this since the perpendicular component is then has we have two components, right? Rather than writing them separately, we can put a vector here where B will be gamma B minus B cross B by C squared. Okay? And if you did the homework exercise where I asked you to do the transformation of calculate the transformation of the Maxwell stress tensor, you would have found the same result. Right? These expressions you can also obtain in different ways. Another way is by looking at what happens with the Hall effect, right? The Hall effect, if you remember, there is a current flowing through some two-dimensional sample, right? And you apply a magnetic field perpendicular to the sample, right? So now the charges which are in this, which are moving, right, the charge carriers, they are moving with some drift velocity dV, right? So they experience a Lorentz force, right? F is equal to q dV cross B. This Lorentz force will cause them to move in a this thing in a trajectory which looks like this. Right? Or the cycloid, one of those points. Right? And you can predict it. The net result is that you get positive charge on one side and negative charge on the other side. And by measuring the potential difference across these two terminals, you can, right, so you get a Hall potential, right? So the Hall potential depends on the width of the sample, the magnetic field strength, and the carrier density. Okay, now you can ask, what is the question one can ask in the context of Lorentz transformations? Different frame, right? Always a different frame. So this different, there's a different frame. How should this frame be set up? Parallel to the motion and with velocity equal to the drift velocity. Right? So you have this observer moving with the same velocity as the charge carriers. Okay? Now, in this observer's frame of reference, what is the velocity of the charge carriers? Zero. So, this magnetic field, can it have any effect on the charge carriers? No. But will this observer see a Hall potential or not? The Hall potential cannot change, right? I mean, it's a Lorentz in there, right? It's like the mass, you measure the mass in one frame of reference, it will be the same in another frame. So, then how do you explain this, right? So, the way to explain it is this relationship, right? So what is happening? Because of the motion, an effective electric field is being generated, right? So the motion, the relative motion is in this direction, the magnetic field is in this direction, okay? So what happens? There is an electric field which is generated in this direction, perpendicular to both of them, right? So this electric field, what will it do? It will have the effect of pushing charge carriers to the sides, right? It will cause this charge separation, and this amount of charge separation will be precisely equal to that required by the measured Hall voltage in the original case. Right? There is no other possibility, right? There is no other possibility. The electric field has to be in the direction perpendicular to both the velocity and the magnetic field. Right, the new electric field, and you can work out this relationship by looking at the fact that if you have this strip, it has some width W, right? So if you have some width W and electric field is some value E prime, then the potential difference is E prime times W, right? And the same potential difference is equal to your Hall potential, which is going to be a function of B and B and W will come in somewhere there. And the end result will be that E prime will be equal to, you will get E prime is equal to some, it will be proportional to V times B. Okay? And then since you know that it has to be perpendicular, that means it will be written in the form V cross B. Right? The remainder rest is to determine the coefficients, right? So those coefficients you can determine by guesswork or by recognizing the fact that this Lorentz force right, so you have again some charge moving in some frame of reference with some velocity U. There is a Lorentz force F which acts on this charge, okay? And then you have some other frame of reference moving at some velocity v with respect to this guy. So the charge in this moving frame of reference has some velocity u prime, which is the relative velocity. And then if you say that in the moving frame of reference, the charge will obey the same Lorentz force equation. Right? If you impose this requirement, then once you know the transformation for the electric field, and you know that the electric field has this factor gamma, then the magnetic field also has to have that factor gamma. And the force also has a factor. So, you can construct a similar thought experiment with V cross E, right? Something which involves electric fields and some velocities perpendicular to that. Okay. I can't think of what it would be exactly. I only have a single force. Okay. So the point of all of this is that electric and magnetic fields are observer dependent, and more importantly, they mix with each other. That is the bottom line after the past 4 hours of lectures, right? They mix with each other. Because they mix with each other, you cannot write down a force, electric field four vector or a magnetic field four vector. Because the transformation would not have any mixing. So we can't write down a four vector for the electric and magnetic. Okay. Then we still want some sort of relativistic object, right? So our goal is to express Maxwell's equations ultimately in a relativistic form. So in a covariant form. Right? That means now Maxwell equation has time derivatives, right? Yes? Time derivatives has spatial derivatives, right? But these are all written separately, right? A covariant equation, what sort of derivative should it have? Relax. understand me. Okay? These are the gamma wire, don't bring that in. Okay? People are already traumatized enough. This much is enough. Or even just this much. Right? So the covariant derivative is what? If I have some function, so this gives me a 4 vector. What are the components of the 4 vector? 1 by c df plus gradient of f. This is d. And then I can also have d mu base, which is equal to minus 1 by c dt gradient. Okay. So we want to write down things, expressions in terms of this guy, right? Because this object can be transformed, can be written as a, it's something that transforms a particular Lorentz structure. Those calculations can be quite stressful. Whenever, aren't you happy now that you can do your project with me? And can you imagine? Every day would be like a scene from Rocky. You've seen Rocky? Anybody seen Rocky? No? You have seen that cheap Indian remake with Sunil Shetty or somebody else? Rocky, nobody knows Rocky. This is the problem with Indian education system. History and culture are completely left out. Go and watch Rocky, okay? YouTube. Anybody who has not seen it, it's a good movie. What are some other good movies? Anybody has any choice of really, really like fantastic movies that you should watch before the end of the world? Before you get, you know, that thing that's going around. Any suggestions? Within a quantum movie, Ganga Kinare, Babaji. I tell you, Saving Private Ryan. Saving Private Ryan. Then Terminator, of course. Only the first two parts. And then Shawshank. Thank you. That's the spirit, man. Shawshank Redemption. And I think Shawshank Redemption has a remake, though I don't think it deserves that title, with Bobby Deol, I think. It's title 2. That has something to do with Shawshank Redemption, but don't go. Anything with Bobby Deol, you can click ignore, not interested. Movies are good, right? They make you. Your good movies, right? They energize your creativity. Right? To a certain extent. Then you have to stop at some point and then actually use that creativity. Okay? So that was my cinematic interview. Coming back to covariant derivatives. So I want to have something in terms of covariant derivatives. Right? Now I don't have anything like this. P mu. There is no electric field force vector, right? But there is a 3 vector electric field and there is a 3 vector magnetic field. How many numbers are those? 6. Right? I have to find some way to put those 6 numbers into some object which I can transform in a relativistic manner, some covariant object. It turns out that, so if a scalar doesn't do the job, then you will use a four vector. If a vector doesn't do the job, what do you do? You use a tensor, a two index object. Well, they are all tensor. Right? Now, you are in four dimensions. So, a tensor has how many indices? 4 by 4, 16. That's a lot of indices. E and B has how many components in total? Six components, right? But now, if you are clever, as all of you are, right? If you are clever, you will know that an anti-symmetric 4x4 matrix has how many components? Yes, it's obviously not 7. Or 5. So it's going to be 6. Anti-symmetric 4x4 matrix has 6 independent components. So you want a tensor, right? Some 4x4 object which is anti-symmetric. Okay, that's a guess, that's a starting. But to get to that point, we need to go through a lot of, we need to go, you know, look at electric fields and write electric fields and magnetic fields in terms of our vector potential, which is our gauge potential. And then in terms of that vector potential, we can finally define this quantity, which is the Maxwell tensor. Okay? And when we define this Maxwell tensor, then we can use the Lorentz transformation. Using the Lorentz transformation tells us immediately how the electric and magnetic fields transform, and we end up with those equations that I have on the board. Okay? So, let's talk about this vector field or gauge field. Okay, so it's actually the correct expression for this is gauge field. So we have this equation of Maxwell's, right? This equation tells us that the quantity B can be written as the curl of some vector A. Okay? Then we have Faraday's law, which tells us that the curl of E is proportional to minus dB by dt. So I can insert this expression here and I get minus d by dt of curl of A. Then spatial derivatives and time derivatives commute with each other, so I can switch the order. I can bring this term over to the left hand side and I can write everything like this. Curl of E plus dA by dt is equal to 0. Right? Now, curl of this quantity is 0, so that means this quantity can be written as the gradient of some scalar. So that means E plus dA by dt is equal to gradient of some scalar. And since we already have a lot of information, we know that, well, it's a good idea to put a minus sign here. Right? Because what is a scalar? This is the potential. And we want the electric field to point from high potential to low potential. So the negative sign. So this tells you that the electric field can be written as dA by dt minus gradient of y. So this is our expression for the electric and magnetic field in terms of this quantity A. Okay, but this A and phi, these quantities are not uniquely defined. Right? We have freedom to choose these quantities. This freedom is what is known as gauge freedom. That's why these are called gauge freedoms. Right? So gauge, to gauge something means to measure something, and so we have a choice in what scale we use, for example, right? So you can think of it like that. The scale, so what can we do? The first equation tells us, the magnetic field equation tells us that we can always take A and add to this A the gradient of some function phi. Right? If you add this function, so you will get a new vector potential A prime. If I put A prime here, so I take curl of A prime, I will get curl of A plus 0. Right? So this is the gauge freedom of the vector potential. Right? But now, if I change A like this, what happens to the electric field? The electric field becomes dA by dt plus B of gradient of phi by dt, right? Minus del phi, right? So the magnetic field is invariant after this transformation. So the magnetic field is equal to curl of A prime is equal to curl of A. But the electric field has this extra term. So to remove this extra term, I have to shift phi. I have to change phi, right? So how should I change phi? Phi should, right? I have a gradient term. I need to shift phi by d chi by d. Right? So if I shift phi by this amount, then I will get over here, I will get minus gradient of d chi by dt. This will cancel and I will be left with the same equation. Right? So what do I have? I have phi goes to phi plus d chi by dt, vector A goes to vector A plus gradient of chi. So I think there is a minus sign that is missing somewhere, right? So this is minus, this has to be plus, this is minus. So phi is shifted by negative of the time derivative and A is shifted by gradient. Okay? Now, you are clever, you are all very clever, right? You realize that while d by dt and gradient, that looks like a formula, right? If I write d by dt, comma, gradient, right? Then, this expression can be written as A mu goes to A mu plus D mu, where A mu is a 4 vector whose components are the scalar field and there is a factor of 1 by C that comes in, I think from here. So there will be a factor of 1 by C in this time derivative. Otherwise, you wouldn't get the correct expression for this. And notice that I'm using d mu with raised. So d mu with raised will be equal to minus 1 by c dt comma raised. Okay? So this is giving us an idea of how we can move forward towards finding a relativistic expression for Maxwell's equations. Okay? Are there any questions? We will have class tomorrow.